Look, over the years, over the last 10 years, through all the diet programs I've tried, through countless hours of research, trial and error, working with other people, coaches, mentors, trying all the stuff on YouTube, I've gotten my approach to my diet and nutrition as a whole so finely tuned that at this point, it feels like I don't even have to try anymore to stay right on top of it. So in this video, I want to help you get to the same place. What's good, YouTube? Your boy John Mangle back again, repping Beyond the Iron. Weekly fitness content is getting dropped on this channel every single week to help you get to those fitness goals faster and more enjoyably. If you're interested in doing that, consider subscribing below. At the end of the video, I wanna share something with you that's gonna help you implement the strategies that I go over, but it's really gonna be a lot of just my perspective, my approach to this stuff. I'm not saying that you need to follow it, but I think you could take some extremely valuable insight that I wish I had when I first started out, because I know how confusing it could be searching all over the internet, finding contradicting evidence time and time again, one telling you to go right, the other telling you to go left, and you just end up not knowing what to do. But with that said, the resource I'm gonna share with you at the end will help you implement it all. All right, the first thing that has allowed me to finally tune my nutrition is something that I know I sound like a broken record with, and I will continue to do so, and it's a good thing because it's something that shows I'm never gonna change my stance on this, as it is a fundamental. And if you can guess what I'm gonna say, comment below and see if you guess it. That's right, it's tracking calories. Not just calories also, by the way, but measuring progress as a whole. Now, one thing people always wonder is, do I have to track calories forever? And the answer is no. However, I would guess I'd track calories probably 340 out of the 365 days of the year, because at this point, it doesn't take me any more than 1 minute a day to play around and input the foods I need to. One, because I've already got a lot of it structured out, and two, because of the experience level I have with it, which, by the way, you can acquire pretty quickly. And so for me, it's just a no-brainer. It's gonna help me stay on my goals a lot faster than if I were to not track, okay? So that's something that I wish I knew off the bat. It would have saved me a lot of hassle from just jumping from one diet to the next. So if you find yourself doing that, this is going to be a huge starting point for you. All right, the next thing is I cook once a week, and it's a big cooking session. You've seen it plenty of times, my meal prep videos. I prep and I cook the bulk of my foods, okay? Now, there's always debate, is food pleasure or fuel? Well, obviously it can be and should be both. However, I do believe that at least 80% of your calories and nutrition should be considered and looked at as fuel to actually fuel your performance, fuel your fitness, fuel your results that will then fuel every other area of your life. And so for that reason, again, I've tried cooking the day of. I know a lot of people like doing that because it stays fresh. That's fine, do it, but it's gonna take more time, it's gonna be more inconvenient, and those two things are gonna heavily weigh on the fact that it's gonna be harder to stick to. I actually remember a time when I was working 80 hours a week at LA Fitness, and I got to the point where I was raking in a lot of money, and I ended up actually paying my mom every single day to cook the meals for me for that day. I would take them, go to work, because that's all I did, was like work, work out, sleep, work, work out, sleep, and repeat. And so I didn't have enough time to cook every single day, and I got my mom, I paid her to cook for me, because I feel like anybody would need an incentive in that case, and she did, and it was great. But I wish I'd have known how much simpler it is, how much more convenient it is to cook once a week. I like Sundays, obviously choose whatever day of the week works best for you, but it's typically gonna be at least 14, sometimes up to 21 meals for the entire week. And don't worry, they all hold in the fridge. People are always worried about that. The key there also, by the way, is to find foods that you are okay with eating every single day. And how do you do that? Well, two ways. One is actually enjoy those foods, right? More than, if you don't like turkey, don't have the turkey, have the ground beef instead. But the second is, like I mentioned, the mentality towards it. Knowing that this is fuel that you're putting in your body, don't expect to enjoy a gourmet tasting type of meal every single day, because it's not realistic, it's not practical, and it's not gonna get you the results you're looking for. So what I do is I cook very basic staple foods up, so I have 80% of my nutrition already set up for me in the fridge waiting for the entire week. And that's something that's huge. Again, I've also tried prepping for 3 days at a time, 4 days, 2 days, all that stuff. 1 week has been the best bet for me so far. Also, keep in mind, I'm filling in the rest of the day with shakes typically, okay? In the morning, I like shakes. I've always used shakes because they're very easy, very malleable. And having all of my nutrition, at least 80% structured out ahead of time, gives me a lot more flexibility, a lot more ability to plan, prepare to include foods that I love, or if I'm going out to a place, going out to a family event and so on, that I can actually fit those foods in without any issues at all. And that is very important. Third thing is I have an amazing relationship with food. I never alienate a food. I never blame a food. I never look at a food as unhealthy. I understand, and you need to understand, that there is no such thing as a unhealthy food, okay? Because the second we give a food that label, we actually turn ourselves into the victim. Because ultimately, practically speaking, in this day and age, there's gonna be times when you eat foods that aren't necessarily ideal, not unhealthy, but not ideal, certain circumstances to get you to your goals. And that labeling starts to make you think things like, oh, I eat unhealthy, I'm not gonna feel so good, it's bad for me, it's gonna make me fat, and all these different things. That's what creates a poor relationship with food. It creates binging, cravings, all these bad things that are associated with it. And so what I understand is, one, of course, you wanna stay prepared, you wanna stay on point so that those temptations don't tug at you and win, but also understand that those temptations are normal and the foods are not the problem, you are. So when you're already structured out, when you've got a plan, guess what? You can include those foods as part of your plan. Because you've planned it out in advance, you can still stay on point, which just goes to show how bad those foods really are not for us. Remember, the dose makes the poison. Sure, if you eat a whole pizza, probably not gonna be very good for you, but if you eat one slice, it could be extremely good for you, for your mental sanity, for your enjoyment, for your adherence. So that's one thing to keep in mind. The relationship with food is key, something it took me a little while to develop, and now that I have it, I wish I had it sooner. Also, keep this in mind. So like I said, I prep everything in advance. Let's say one of those events does come up. Maybe I'm gonna go out later. I wake up on Saturday morning, and as the morning goes on, I figure out, okay, there's different things that I can choose to do later on. Maybe I go out with friends. Maybe we got a family event, right? Whatever the case is. So what I'll do is I'll look at what my plan was for that day when it comes to my food. And again, this takes a couple minutes at most. And what I'll do is I'll start playing around with this different scenario. So maybe say, you know what? Maybe I will have some pizza tonight. So what I'll do, I'll tweak around a little bit before I've eaten all my calories, of course. I'll play around and I'll find a way to make it fit. In other words, I've got a plan A when I'm starting off the day, but it's subject to change because I understand that it's inevitable if you want to have a life and still see results. And so I'll take the 2 minutes to play around, find a combination I like, and then I know, okay, great, I'm gonna go out to so-and-so's house tonight, or I'm gonna go out to the restaurant, you know, with my family or whoever, and I'm gonna have this food, this amount, and I'm going to stay on track. And let me tell you, when you do that, you will be liberated from ever questioning yourself, from ever being upset, from ever just going in and shooting blind in the dark when you go to a restaurant, and which likely ends up leading to you ruining your results. So that's something very important. I hope that's a very practical tip that you can start applying and watch the change it makes to your life. Okay, the next thing is I actually have zero attachment to any of the data. So remember I said tracking progress, so workouts as well as nutrition, calories, weigh-ins. But when I track them, I have zero attachment to them. I do not put an expectation on those numbers because that's where problems arise, right? So we have to understand that there are so many physiological things happening under the surface that we simply cannot control in our day-to-day lives. And so for that reason, when I'm gonna step on the scale and in my mind I say I should go down by 2 pounds and I don't, that attachment to the number or that expectation you set is going to cause you to feel demotivated, it's gonna make you upset, it's gonna make you, all the issues that are associated with weighing yourself comes with that. Same with the calories. Just because I tracked X amount of calories, I know that it's impossible to track 100% accurately. Just because the food label says it so, doesn't mean that you're gonna nail it right on the head, right? There's so many factors at play, and so for that reason, I definitely invite you to just relinquish attachment you have to these numbers, but make sure that you use them every single day because when you do, you have a much higher chance of moving in the right direction. You have a much higher chance of being okay with the times that things don't go as you expected them to, and you start to understand and love the process a lot more. And as a result, of course, you get to your goals faster. Now, next is I do know which foods not to have around me. So I offer you to do the same. You know, like I'm always constantly testing different variables. I'm testing meal timing. And that's the next point, by the way, is that I'm always testing. I'm always trying to refine and optimize my nutrition. I recommend you do the same, but not by switching all the variables at once. Instead, like I mentioned this whole video, have your staple, have your plan. And from there, try to change one variable the next week. So maybe change what time you start eating at, or maybe change the last meal, what time you have that at, and start to find what works better and better for you, right? For your current schedule, your lifestyle, etc. And part of that is testing. Like I'll go to the store and I'll buy some sort of a quote unquote junk or calorie dense food because I want to see if I can fit that into my day to day without going overboard. But there are some times, I'm human too, that those foods just cause me to binge all the time. It's just too hard for me to hold back. And so for that reason, which obviously comes with some experience and some maturity, I do not buy those foods. I try not to keep them around me, and it makes things a lot easier. So those are two tips in one. One is understand what foods you should just stay away from, what foods you can incorporate and when, and also always test and try to refine your approach to dieting, because it's never perfect, but it's always worth pursuing perfection in that area. So always test one variable at a time, week to week. Of course, this is a long-term game. Don't expect any drastic changes in 2 weeks as everybody likes to. It's a lifelong game. And so with that said, you just follow this advice and you will be light years ahead of anybody else, especially me, if you learn this within the first year or couple of years of you, of your nutrition and dieting and fitness journey. So I hope that you found it helpful for that reason. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, please drop them in the comment section below. I'll be sure to reply. And also don't forget to like the video if you liked it. And if you didn't like it, just hit the like button anyways, because if not, you're gonna get roasted. Unless you wanna, that's fine with me. It's always a fun time. Also, don't forget to share with your friends and subscribe, because I drop videos every damn week. So I'll see you in the next one. I'm out.